Thank you. Hey, good morning, everybody. How is everybody? Doing good? Church is going to look a little different this morning. Please remain standing. Mario's going to come and read the word.
Yes. Since it's Super Bowl weekend, Pastor Marty's calling an audible and changing things up here today. So we're doing the reading of the scripture after this first song. And after reading this, I believe Remnant and Haven will be dismissed too, right? Okay. So today we'll be reading out of Hebrews 11, 6, and then 17 and 19. I'm reading from the NLT version, and we'll begin with 11, 6. And it is impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who sincerely seek him. 17 and 19. It was by faith that Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice when God was testing him. Abraham, who had received God's promises, was ready to sacrifice his only son, Isaac, even though God had told him, "Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted." Abraham reasoned that if Isaac died, God was able to bring him back to life again. And in a sense, Abraham did receive his son back from the dead. You know, so we've read these verses before, and I'm always astonished when I read that, and I remember reading it for the first time. Here you have Abraham being asked by God to take his only son and ultimately to sacrifice him. You know, I don't think I could do that if I was asked. But this is what Abraham showed us, and what we've learned from the scripture is he had unwavering faith and unwavering belief and trust. How did Abraham display that amazing confidence in faith and belief? By wholeheartedly seeking God. Abraham knew God. He believed in God with unwavering belief and trust. And what did he all believe in? And he knew God would bring his son back to life again, which means he adhered to God's promises and he received them. So we have that same access. We have that same access. And to close in just what Hebrews 11:1 says, that what faith is, it is the confident assurance that what we hope for is going to happen. Just like Abraham hoped and knew what was going to happen, and is the evidence of the things that we cannot yet see. It is with God that we can accomplish our tasks. So again, we just thank you, God, for your word and who you are. And we just ask that you continue to dwell amongst us in our minds and our heart. And most importantly, will you help us obey them? In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Mario. We're going to start the message right now. So if you got your Bibles, I am going to read the text, and then I just want to say something. Remnant and Haven, you are dismissed. The message today is called God Tests You Because He Loves You. Isn't that a great title? You're like, I'm not sure on that one. God tests you because he loves you. But we're in Genesis 22. We're going to read the text. Genesis 22. I'll give you a moment. I hear pages turning. I caught you off guard. I called an audible, as Brother Mario said. Genesis chapter 22, verse 1. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him.
that on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey, the lad, and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went together. But Isaac spoke to Abraham his father and said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. Then he said, look, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Then they came to the place of which God had told them, and Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order, and he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, here I am. And he said, do not lay your hand on the lad, nor do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide. As it is said, to this day in the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. Father, as we look at this story, it's an amazing story. It's an unbelievable story. But it has so much for us to learn about faith and about you. And we know that you do love us. And because you love us, you put tests in our lives. But they're not tests to be avoided. They're tests to get through because you have great plans for our lives. And may we learn that today as we learn about Abraham. So bless our time in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, before we start this, I want to just say my wife and I have had a couple tough weeks, and I just want to thank you for you guys praying for us. She had some stuff in her eyes that has happened, and we were in ER for 14 hours last Saturday, and they were talking about a big mass back there, a big infection, and we had people praying, and that it just disappeared. And we praise God for that. But she's not out of the woods yet. She has I tried to pronounce it, and I did it all wrong. So she said, don't even pronounce it, honey. So there's something in her eye where she, it's like if she looks, it's like looking through a windshield that's full of mud on her one eye. And but we're praying. We're praying that God is going to heal her and take care of her. And she told me, I can tell this part. She had a stroke in her eye. Where the blood vessel was enlarged and everything. So that was causing this problem. So just keep praying with us, and we thank you. We're so grateful that we have a church that prays for us, because you have the medical part as one part, but then the spiritual warfare with your mind and all the different things and stuff like that. And I'm just so grateful for all you guys praying for us. So thank you. So we're talking about Abraham, and the title of this message that I said is God tests you because he loves you. And if you look in the very beginning, it says in verse 1, now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham. God tested Abraham. But it says after these things. After what things? Well, all the things that he'd been going through. If you look at the previous 10 chapters as we've been going over the life of Abraham, we found that God called him out of the Ur of the Chaldeans to go to a land that he didn't even know where it was. Great thing he did that. Then he built altars and he called on the name of the Lord. And then later in chapter 12, there was a famine and they went down to Egypt. And sadly, they went down to Egypt, but they should have trusted the Lord, and he actually lied about his wife Sarah. That was a bad move. But then the next chapter, he does good again. He breaks away from the carnal lot. And God speaks to him and gives him the promise again. And then he returns and builds an altar again. Chapter 14, He delivers Lot and all of the people that from Sodom, because there was a big armies that took away all the people, and he brought the goods back. Chapter 15, God makes a covenant with them and says, do not be afraid. I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. And he made this covenant with them. But then chapter 16, him and Sarah come up with a plan that wasn't very good about a lady named Hagar. So he didn't do so good there. But then chapter 17, God's speaking truth to Abraham again, and he circumcised his whole household, and he's back on the track. He's doing a great job. And then in chapter 18 and 19, he intercedes for Sodom when there was going to be judgment. He was a prayer warrior. And then in chapter 20, he goes to Gerar, and he lies about his wife Sarah like he did earlier. Not so good. But then immediately right after that, Isaac comes, the promised son, after 25 years. And then he gets rid of Hagar. He sends Hagar and Ishmael out of the house. And all of these things were happening in Abraham's life for this right here. Those are all these things before he gets to the test of tests. He gets to the biggest test of his life. And all of those things lead up to it. You know, I love what Pastor Chuck has always said. Everything is preparation for something else. Everything in your life is preparation for something else. The good, the bad, and the ugly, if you will. The blessings, the challenges, the times we fall, all that is used for God's glory, and that's what he's doing in the life of Abraham. And the Bible says to count it all joy when you fall in various trials, knowing the testing of your faith produces patience, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be complete and mature, lacking nothing. How do you count it joy going through a trial? Well, it says count it joy knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. God allows trials and tests to make us more mature in the Lord, to make us useful for his kingdom, to where we will develop a heart of faith and compassion and understanding for others. And sometimes we go through some terrible things, and sometimes God delivers us out of things, and sometimes he doesn't. But either way, God is good, and God uses it for his glory. All things work together for good to those who are called of God, or who love God and are the called according to his purpose. And it goes on to say that he predestined us to be conformed in the image of Christ, Jesus Christ. Part of the process is we are being conformed to the image of Jesus. Bible says about Jesus, he learned obedience by the things he suffered. It's through those sufferings and those tough times, the ones that we don't like, we don't want, we don't understand, we want to refrain from them, but God uses that. God uses that. And that's what he's doing with Abraham. And he says, here I am. That is such a great attitude of a servant. Abraham, Abraham, here I am. I think of little Samuel, young Samuel, when he was in the temple and he was going to be the next prophet, and he's sleeping, and he and the Lord calls out, Samuel, Samuel. He runs to Eli and goes, here I am, here I am. Well, actually, Eli told him, hey, it's God calling you, not me calling you. But he had the same attitude, here I am. In the book of Isaiah chapter 6, when you have that great angelic situation with Isaac, he says, I saw the Lord high, you know, seated up in the train of his temple, filled the glory of the temple. And God says, who will I send? Who will go for us? He said, here I am, send me. That's what Abraham is. He's like Private Abraham, or come as ordered, sir, whatever you want, you know. Here I am. And I love that about Abraham. He didn't ask what he wanted to do. He just said, here I am. And I have 5 points in this study for you note takers. First is the test of faith. That's what we're talking right here in verse 1 and 2, the test of faith. Then the second point is going to be the beginning of faith. That's in verses 3 and 4. Then we're going to have verbal faith. That's the next point. And then after that, we're going to have, after the verbal faith, we're going to have point 4, which is what I call moment of truth faith. And then the last point is going to be God, is the result of our faith, God-fearing faith. But right now, this is the test. He's giving him the test. He says, take now your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Whom you love. I find it interesting, he says, your only son, because we know he had Ishmael, right? Abraham, I know you love this son of yours, but this is what I'm asking you to do. And I love how he offers that up. He offers this, he doesn't offer it, he makes this statement, offer up your son, your only son, to the land of Moriah, to offer him there as a burnt offering. And I'm just amazed how he knows this, that Abraham's going to hurt, because Abraham, he knows Abraham. But think about that. What if God asked you to give up the most important person or thing in your life? Just think of that. Let that sink in. Sometimes he delivers and sometimes he doesn't. But that's a tough thing to think about. So he was telling him, I know that. Think about that. This is the son of promise, the son he loves so much. All the promises of God are wrapped up in this young boy, and God's telling him to offer up. I think, and many think, that Isaac was becoming an idol to Isaac, or to Abraham, and even Sarah. This was their promised son, and I could just imagine he was doting over Isaac and spending all this time with him, and maybe he put Isaac before God, and sometimes we can do that. Here's a danger of, there's always a danger of loving the promise more than the promiser. Think about that. There's a danger of loving the promise more than the promiser. Sometimes somebody may pray for, they're praying for such a long time to get a husband or to get this ministry or to get a home or get this job, and all of a sudden they get that thing that God gave them, and now all their attention is on that thing, and they forget the God who gave it to them. That may have been what was happening here. And that leads to point two. Point two is beginning faith. The test of faith we just talked about, now beginning faith. Is Abraham going to move on this? Well, he sure does. Look at verse 3. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey. I love that. He rose early in the morning, first thing up. He goes, I'm going to do what God's called me to do. He did this way back in last chapter, 21, chapter 21, verse 14, when he was told to take Ishmael and Hagar out away from them. And verse 14 says, so Abraham rose early in the morning, the same words. When God gives you something to do, the best thing you can do is do it, is just do it instantly. And it says he rose and he saddled his donkey. He obeyed immediately, no partial delayed obedience. He obeyed. And I thought about this. He didn't give the enemy of the soul or of his flesh the opportunity to talk him out of it. Have you ever heard of the paralysis of analysis? That means you start thinking about, well, did God really call me? Well, what if this happened? You know, you start talking about it, and the next thing you know, don't even do it. Abraham's like, I'm not going there. First thing in the morning, I'm getting up. Abraham also teaches us that we walk by faith. It says it in 2 Corinthians 5:7, we walk by faith. We don't walk by sight, which means we don't walk by what we see or what our emotions tell us or what others tell us or what we see on TV. Even well-meaning friends and family will tell us their point of view. We walk by faith in what God says. Because the Bible says in Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? God knows it. God knows what our hearts are thinking. And he's like, I don't even want to think about this, Lord. I'm just going to do it. And I just love it how he takes this step of faith, the step of obedience. And I love how it says he saddled his donkey. You know, we were at the Rodeo Cafe the other day, and they had a little sign there, a little quote by John Wayne, and it said this: courage is being scared to death but saddling up anyways. I like that. That sounds like a cowboy. Courage is being scared to death but saddling up anyways. And that's what Abraham did. He saddled the donkey because I'm not thinking about it. I'm scared to death, but Lord, I am following you. And then he split the wood. See, he showed that he didn't go by feelings. He just went by what God wanted him to do. And here's something to think about. While Abraham was thinking through the sacrifice, he was obeying God. And while he was obeying God, he was thinking through the sacrifice. Let me say that again. While Abraham was thinking through the sacrifice, he was obeying God. And while he was obeying God, he was thinking through the sacrifice. Not understanding the test didn't stop him from obeying. See, sometimes we think, I need all the facts, I need all the answers, I got to have it figured out. And God says, just trust me. And that's what Abraham did. And then it says, on the third day, that's compared to the story of Jesus. By the way, we're going to talk about this entire story is a parallel of God the Father offering his son Jesus up on the mount as a sacrifice for our sins. But for 3 days, both Isaac and Jesus were dead, if you would. Jesus was dead. Isaac was presumed dead for 3 days. But he also had 3 days to think about it, because it says he lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And I just thought, how grueling that must have been inside to be even thinking it. And it's a reminder of that's where the battle usually is in our mind of what we're thinking. And that's why you're always hearing me say, you got to be in church, you got to be in God's word, you got to be a worshiper. You got to be all in with allowing God to get into your mind and not allow the thoughts and all of the things of the world, which will just totally derail us and frustrate us. That leads to number three, verbal faith. We talked about the test of faith, beginning faith. Now we're talking verbal faith. He is going to verbalize his faith. Verse 5, the lad and I will go yonder and worship. This is actually the first recorded words that Abraham has in this little story here. He says, the lad and I will go yonder and worship. You know, you've heard me say this, and there's a Bible verse, other pastors have taught about it. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. You guys heard of that? We usually use that to think of what we say to others. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. You can build somebody up or you can cut someone down. You can speak life or you can speak death. That goes for the words we say. We can speak words of faith or we can speak words of fear. And Abraham's like, I'm speaking words of faith right here. I'm going to do what God told me to do. The lad and I, we are going to go yonder to worship. Because once you speak it to someone, you're generally going to do it. You know what I'm saying? When God put it on my heart to do what we're doing right now, which is have church, I didn't have an idea, no idea what we were doing. I guess we still don't, but I'm glad no one clapped at that. I'm glad no one clapped. No, stop. So what happened was, and I've told you the story a bunch of times, but basically, Lori had quit her job a few years ago. We thought God was calling us out then. That was a test. And then he says, no, now you got to get rid of your job. And I'm like, okay, you know. And so I'm praying, and I'm like, okay, this is going to happen. But it didn't happen until I got my beautiful bride and says, guess what the Lord's doing, hon? We's leaving. And she goes, what? But once I spoke it, it's like, okay, now I got to do it. I just told her. So we made an appointment. I went and talked to my admin pastor and told him this is what God put on our heart. We're going to take a step of faith. We don't know what it's going to do. But it wasn't until I spoke it that I took the next step. You knew who else who spoke it at a much, much, much more deeper level and then moved forward on it? Jesus. Jesus said, not my will, but yours be done in the garden. He knew for years what was coming his way. But when it got down to it, he was in prayer. He's, Lord, if there's any other way, and God says, not my will. Or God says, no, there's not another way. He says, not my will, but yours be done. And then he moved on it. Within hours, he was going to get arrested, and he was going to move on it. But it gets to the point where you got to speak it before you take the next step. And I also like how he says here, he speaks faith because he says, we will come back to you. First of all, he says, I will go yonder and worship. And worship, we've probably heard this before. Worship is obedience, right? But you know what? Really, really hard obedience is like major worship. You know what I'm saying? Like it's easy if God says, Abraham, take your son, your only son Isaac, go into the town and buy some ice cream. Like, what's with that? So, yeah, okay, great. Nothing there. Go sacrifice your son. Whoa, that's worship. You're obeying, especially when it's difficult. And this is what it says in Romans 12:1. I urge you, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And that's what we are as Christians. We're to have our lives as a living sacrifice, not just a one time you give something, but your whole life. It says it's our reasonable service, meaning it's the rational, logical thing to do because of God's mercy that he's put in our lives by sending Christ to die for our sins. And Jesus is doing this. He's worshiping. Worship means to bow down to God's will. That's what Jesus did. And that's what basically Abraham's doing. He's going to obey God's will. But then he says this, I love this next phrase, and we will come back to you. See, now he's speaking faith. Before he's just, okay, I'm going to do it. But now he's speaking faith like he believes God's going to do something crazy. Mario just read that great passage out of Hebrews 11 where it says Abraham concluded that God could raise him from the dead. Is that amazing faith or what? But he was probably talking the promises of God in his head when God had says, hey, like the stars in the sky and like the sand on the sea, that's how much of a multitude is going to come from your descendants. And he had told him, okay, Abram, you're not Abram anymore. You're Abraham, father of multitude. He told him that when he didn't even have any kids. And then he said, nations are going to come for you. And he says, and from your wife, kings will come from her. So all these promises are probably going through his head like, well, how is this all going to happen? Well, he concluded that God would raise him from the dead. And what's crazy is there's no resurrections in the Bible up until this time. We are able to look at the story and look at the rest of the Bible and see that there were resurrections in the Bible. Abraham didn't have that. You know what he had? He had faith. He had great faith, and he's a model to us. And then Isaac asks the obvious question in verse 7, where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Hey, we got the fire, we got the wood, where's the lamb? And then Abraham has to just say, In verse 8, he goes, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb as a burnt offering. God will provide for himself as a lamb of a burnt offering. And we're going to see that he does that. But notice it says the two of them went together. Look at the end of verse 6. The two of them went together. We have father and son going together. And this is a reminder that God is with us when we go through tough times. Jesus wrote this in John 8:29, and he who has sent me is with me. He said, the Father has not left me alone because I always do those things that please him. Especially when you're doing the things that please the Lord. Remember the passage that Jesus said, I'm with you always to the end of the age? You know what he said right before that? Go into all the nations and make disciples of them, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. He's using that in the context of discipleship. When you're making disciples, when you're doing my kingdom work, you can guarantee I'm going to be there. And so he was with them. And guys, that's how the Lord is with us. Whatever you're going through, he is there. David wrote in Psalm 23, that precious psalm. Every Christian should know Psalm 23. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack. I shall not be in want. He makes me to lie down by the green pastures. He brings me to the still waters. He restores my soul. And then he leads me in paths of righteousness for his namesake. But then he says this amazing verse, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I am with you. I am with you. I will be with you. That's one of the biggest promises in all of Scripture, this quick little phrase. Fear not, I am with you. Fear not, I am with you. You see it all through the Old Testament. And Jesus would say, don't have little faith. Don't believe. You know, he says, I am with you. And Jesus was with him. And you know, I can't help but think of those young Hebrew kids. There was a song years ago called Another in the Fire. You know what I'm talking about? And especially you youngsters, anybody that's young here. Well, this is for everybody, but there's these young teenagers in Babylon, and the king is just like a lot of kings. I'm not going to mention any names, but a lot of big leaders are all about themselves, right? So this dude builds this big idol and says, everybody fall down and worship it. If you don't worship it, you're going in the fire. Everybody bows down, and then there's just like three teenagers just kind of like, I'm not bowing. Who are those three guys? He throws them in the fire, and you know what it says? It didn't burn them. And the king looks in there and goes, hey, wait a second. We threw three guys in there. There's a fourth in there, and he looks like the Son of God. That was Jesus in the fire. God is with you when you are struggling. God is with you in the fire. But also, I also think it mentions it twice because it says Isaac willingly went with his father. Jesus did the same thing. This is what it says about Jesus in John 10:17. Therefore, my Father loves me because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. It's just such a picture of this story of Jesus. And now we come to point four, moment of truth, faith. We could talk about faith. We can begin faith. We can verbalize faith. But until we get to that point of what God told us to do, we haven't really had that. And this is the moment of truth faith. And in verse 10, it says, and Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. Wow. Now, whose obedience do you think was harder, Abraham's or Isaac's? That's a tough question. It's hard either way. I want to read something. Matthew Henry, in his commentary, I saw this little passage about this, and I never thought about it. And he talked about how Abraham made a weary step with a heavy heart, and he finally arrives at that fatal place, and he builds this altar where Isaac is going to die. And then he tells Isaac the amazing news. Isaac, you are the lamb which God has provided. I don't know if he had to say that, but he said, and Isaac is as willing as Abraham. We do not find that he raised any objection against it, and he petitioned for his life, that he attempted to make his escape, much less that he struggled with his aged father or made any resistance. God will have it done. And Isaac has learned to submit to both. Abraham, no doubt, comforting him with the same hopes with he himself by faith was comforted, yet it is necessary that a sacrifice be bound. The great sacrifice, which in the fullness of time was to be offered up, must be bound, and therefore so must Isaac. And this is the part that got me. Having bound him, he lays him upon the altar and his hand upon the head of his sacrifice. And now we may suppose with floods of tears, he gives and takes the final farewell of a parting kiss. This being done, he resolutely forgets the heart of a father and puts on the awful gravity of a sacrificer. And with a fixed heart and an eye lifted to heaven, he takes the knife and stretches out his hand to give a fatal cut to Isaac's throat. Be astonished, O heavens, at this, and wonder, O earth. Here is an act of faith and obedience which deserves to be a spectacle to God and to angels and to men. As we know, God said, don't do that. But it's amazing. I like the way he describes about, you know, we could just blow by this, but this is his son. And he sees him laying there. But God has called him to do this. And I'm sure he was crying. I'm sure it was hard. And anytime we do anything for the Lord, it's hard. But I'm so blessed to know that our God is faithful to see us through this and to strengthen us. And that's what he did here. And now my computer's going on the blank. All righty then. Okay, so anyways. But what's so amazing is he stops him. He stops him. And Jeff Lassane at Harvest used to say this, aren't you glad Abraham wasn't hard of hearing? You know what I'm saying, right? Okay, so I'm getting back here. But I just love what the Lord does here with, I'm going to ask my wife to fix this. And if I don't use it, I don't use it. So I love the fact that he makes this amazing step of faith, and the angel of the Lord says, Abraham, Abraham, and he says, here I am. Here is that faithful servant again, Lord, here I am. Because he said, here I am the first time, and God showed him the test, when he said, here I am the second time, God gave him the deliverance. See, and he obeyed God, and God is calling us to obey and to trust even when we don't feel like it. And I love how he says, do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. He says, Abraham will do anything for me now. If he's willing to do this, he'll do anything. He passed the test with flying colors. And so did you, dear. Thank you. This is why it's good to have a godly wife, guys. When you're on the line and it's like you're out there by yourself, you need someone like that. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Oh, my gosh. So anyways, what I like about this, too, is this is one of those things that we could never understand. Why would God ask him to do this? Well, God was never, ever, ever intending him to do this. It says it was a test. God knew he was going to stop him. God wasn't going to let him go through with this. But here's the thing. Small tests, small testimonies. Big tests, big testimonies. This is a big test. This is a big testimony. Some of the biggest, toughest things that we face in our life, those are the biggest, greatest testimonies that God uses. Here's the thing. In a pagan world of idolatry and worship of false gods, they thought it was the supreme act of a love for your God if you would sacrifice a human life. And that's what they would do. And that's Abraham showing to all these other pagan religions, this is wrong. This is not what God calls you to do. Watch, my God's not going to have me do this. God hates human sacrifice. He hates the shedding of innocent blood. And one of the worst ones in this culture was offering to the god of Molech, which was a form of abortion back in that day. It's a heartbreaking thing where they would offer their little babies to this Molech. It was terrible. God says, thou shalt not murder, and he hates the shedding of innocent blood. But what's so interesting is this is an act of God's, of Abraham's supreme love for God. Here's a verse you probably heard in the Bible that has probably puzzled you. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, in his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. What are you saying? God wants us to hate our family? No. The word he uses for hate is like saying anyone who loves God less, or, you know, loves people more than they love God, that's not the type of person to follow me. I mean, we love our family. God's not telling us to get rid of our family, but he needs to be the supreme love. He needs to be, there should be no rivals on the throne of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Are you guys with me on that? There should be no rival. Only he went to the cross for our sins. It says in Colossians 1:18, he in all things, he is to have the preeminence. I love this passage, Jude 25 in the New Living Translation. All glory to him who alone is God, all our Savior through Jesus Christ our Lord. All glory, majesty, power, and authority are his before all time and in the present and beyond all time. Amen. God is the only one that we worship and praise. We love our families. We love people. But that love of God is to be numero uno for you Mexican-speaking people. I mean, what did Jesus say when they said, what is the first greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. Did you get the all part of it? Y'all? Another bad joke. That leads to point five. The result is God-fearing faith. When you are given that test of faith, and you begin in faith, and then you verbalize your faith, and then you pass the moment of truth test of your faith, the result is you have a God-fearing faith. Look at verse 12. And he said, do not lay your hand on the lad, nor do anything for him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son. He goes, I know that you fear God. You proved it to me, Abraham. And that's what the test was. The test was, gave Abraham, do you love Isaac more than you love me? And he passed the test with flying colors. But I love how the angel called out to him. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 1:14, angels are ministering spirits to minister to those who will inherit salvation. However, this says the angel of the Lord. Angel of the Lord is an angel, but the angel of the Lord refers to Jesus Christ. And often we quote this passage in Psalm 37:34-7. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. I love that. He camps around those who fear him and he delivers them. But I love how he just jumped in there and says, you have passed the test. You are going to be in the hall of faith. He is in the hall of faith. He's in Hebrews 11. We just read it. You don't get into the hall of faith by not taking great steps of faith and doing things that a lot of others wouldn't do. That's why they were in there. It's been said, tests don't produce faith. They reveal faith. He had this faith. He just revealed it by passing this test. There's an African proverb that says, smooth seas don't make skillful sailors. Think about that. Smooth seas don't make skillful sailors. And that's just in life. You want somebody that's weathered the storms, that had worst case scenario, and they've been able to come through it, instead of somebody that's never had a challenge, never had a trial, and they're going to be flying the plane or driving the ship. It's like, no, thank you. Abraham is proving he has tremendous faith, and that can be trusted. And then it says he lifted his eyes and looked, and there was a ram. Behind him, it was caught in the thicket. Notice the ram doesn't appear until after he had obeyed God. And that's often how it works. He doesn't answer the prayer or meet the need until after you've obeyed. You know, sometimes we're like, okay, God, I'll do this if you do this. And God's like, no, you do this, and then I'll do this. I'm God, you're not. You know, we always want a little something out there first to tell us that it's him or that he's going to do this thing. He goes, you just trust me and I'll show up. You know, and this reminds us, it says, the next verse, it says that Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide. If God guides, God provides. I heard that. I think Chuck Smith said that, but that's a good word. If God's calling you to something, he's going to provide everything you need, whether it's strength, faith, compassion, finances, opportunities, open doors. If he's called you to something, he is going to get you there. If he's going to bring you to it, he's going to get you through it. That's our God. He's not going to leave us out there. You know, someone might say, I could never do what Abraham did. God's not calling you to do what Abraham did. Whatever he calls you to, he's going to give you the strength to do it when you need it. In fact, I love this passage in Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help when? In time of need. Often God shows up when we need him. He strengthens us when we need him. We look at, I can never go through that. I can never do what he or she did. You're right, because you're not there yet. But when you get there, if he gives you that, I guarantee he'll give you everything you need. God is faithful. And he's faithful even when it doesn't seem like it. Even when it's, you know, we don't feel it. Like, you know, Jesus promises to get us through every storm, but he doesn't always promise to take the storm away. He's with us. He's with us because he loves us. Did you know the Lord will provide for you? Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." And what things is he talking about? Well, he had just been talking about whatever you're going to eat, whatever you're going to drink, whatever you're going to wear. He says, don't worry about it. The non-believers worry about everything. But you seek first my kingdom and my righteousness, and I will provide your needs. I will give you whatever you need. Don't worry about it. But we got to put him first. Often it's that you do your part and God does his part. And that's what's happening. That's what he talks about. But this Jehovah Jireh, the Lord provides. We sung Jireh a couple Sundays in a row. The Lord provides. He's everything I need. He is. Even when we don't feel it. What's interesting, he says, God will provide himself the lamb, but he brought a ram. You ever thought about that? He says, I'll bring you a lamb, but it was actually a ram. Well, the real lamb is going to come 1,900 years later. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's what happened there. And I just want to finish off with four reasons God told Abraham to sacrifice his son. Four reasons why he told him to do this. Number one, he's showing human sacrifice is wrong. Thou shalt not kill. He is not endorsing that at all. And he stopped Abraham. He's showing that is wrong. Number two, the sacrifice God wants is a spiritual living sacrifice, not a human sacrifice. He doesn't want you to sacrifice your life. He wants you to live your life as a living sacrifice. 1 Samuel 15:22, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. I mean, Abraham could have done all these other great things, and God would say, well, what about Isaac? I don't care what you did. I don't care how many things you did for other people, how many other sacrifices you did, how much money you made for my kingdom, how much you helped people. He goes, I asked you to do this one thing. That's what I care about. I heard about a wife that her husband would call her from work sometimes and say, honey, could you take care of this for me? Oh, yeah, I'll get it. And he'd come home and she wouldn't do it. And she'd say, well, look what all these other things I did. And he's going, well, that's fine, honey, but what about the thing I really needed to be done? This is the woman who shared this. She realized, looking back, ooh, I'm not really doing what I was supposed to do. That's kind of how it is with God. God tells us to do something, and we're like, ooh, but I'll do all these other good things, and maybe God will be okay with it. God says to obey is better than the sacrifices that you want to offer. The only sacrifice that you would offer is the one that I tell you to offer. That's what Abraham was. He didn't try to give God a plan B or plan C. He just obeyed. The third reason is to show a forever picture of the sacrifice of Christ at Calvary for the sins of the world. This is one of the greatest passages. If you're ever sharing with a Jewish person that hasn't accepted Christ as their Messiah, and you're trying to tell about Jesus, take them to this passage. And then take them to Isaiah 53 and Psalm 22 and some other places. But this is like the greatest picture of God offering his son Jesus Christ. Both were miracle babies that were prophesied about before. Isaac was prophesied way back, and God already gave Abraham and Isaac, or Sarah, the name Isaac. Jesus was prophesied in the Old Testament, and the angel told Joseph what to name Jesus. They didn't just come up with this name on their own. Both of these, Isaac and Jesus, were tested and submitted to their father. Both of them carried wood to the sacrifice. Isaac carried firewood. Jesus carried a cross. Both were the only son whom the father loved. Both sacrifices were on Mount Moriah. Did you know that? Mount Moriah is where Abraham brought up Isaac. Mount Moriah is where the Ten Commandments were received and where the temple was built. And Mount Moriah is where Jesus was crucified, up in that area of Mount Moriah. Both on the third day, God brought deliverance. Jesus was dead for 3 days, and then God raised him from the dead. For 3 days, Abraham's wrestling with this Isaac. I gotta do this. And then God gave him deliverance. Both times God provided the lamb for the sacrifice. Both fathers believed in God's resurrection power. In both, innocent blood was shed. And in both, the sacrifice was a substitute. The ram was a substitute for Isaac. Jesus was a substitute for you and me. For you and me. Yet, unlike Abraham, God the Father did not spare his son Jesus. He allowed his death. Why? Because of his love for us. Because of his love for you and me. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believes in him will have everlasting life. He gave his son. He willingly sacrificed his son for our sins. In the kingdom of heaven parables, Jesus in Matthew 13 has all these kingdom parables, and two of them, one's called the hidden treasure, one's called the pearl of great price. And in both of them, somebody sold all they have so they could get the treasure. The other ones, they sold all they could have for they had the great pearl. And God gave it all for us. He gave up his son. He sacrificed it because of the love he had for us. The Bible says in Isaiah 53 that the Lord was pleased that he bruised Jesus. And that's kind of like, what? He was pleased because of what he saw it would accomplish. Same thing with Jesus in Hebrews 12. It says, for the joy set before him, you are the joy that God did this for. And number four, to show that God does test people. Abraham was well over 100 years old when he faced the greatest test in his life. I found this quote by Warren Wiersbe. I thought it was really good. We are never too old to face new challenges, fight new battles, and learn new truths. When we stop learning, we stop growing. And when we stop growing, we stop living. Think about that. When we run away from God's test, I don't want any part of this, you are missing out from growing in your faith. When faced with a great trial, our attitude shouldn't be, take this away, how can I get out of this? But what is God teaching me, and how can I glorify him in this? You know, Charles Stanley said, the hotter the fire, the purer the gold. And that's true. The hotter the fire, the purer the gold. You know, the Bible says many are called and few are chosen. And there's two thoughts on that verse. One is it's a salvation verse. One is God calls everybody, but only a few were chosen because there are only a few are actually willing to believe Christ and to give their life to him. But I believe that's also a calling for service. Many are called to serve God, but only a few are chosen. Why? Because only a few are willing to pass the test and sacrifice or give up things to serve God. Many of us, we want our own creature comforts, so we're not willing to take that step, or we're not willing to let go of that thing or whatever. And we miss out on that opportunity. A.W. Tozer said, God never uses anyone greatly until he afflicts them deeply. That's a real hard verse there. You know, sometimes God brings deliverance and sometimes he doesn't. I think of Joni Erickson Tada, and I was thinking of Helen Keller. These two ladies Joni was a quadriplegic, and Helen Keller, I believe, was deaf and blind and a few other things. But both of these women on numerous occasions says, I wouldn't trade it from the world. I've never been closer to my Lord and Savior than ever because of these trials. And God has used me to reach literally thousands of people, maybe millions, probably millions because they read their books. But they said, you cannot take my relationship away from the Lord from me, and you would if you did that. They got it. But I have a question here. Is there something you are holding on to, or that is an idol that God is telling you need to give it up and let it go? Something that is or is threatening to be more important than the Lord? My prayer is that God would reveal to everyone here if there is something that God is telling you to give up. Are you withholding something from God, something that is an idol, or something that will destroy you or even hurt those around you? God knew Abraham loved him and feared nothing because he withheld nothing in verse 12. He said, since you have withheld, this is the absolute surrender where his faith was at the highest point, at that moment of truth, that moment of faith. That's when his faith was at the highest. And I think of Hebrews 12:1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. That's Hebrews 12, which follows Hebrews 11. Pretty smart, huh? Well, Hebrews 11 is the hall of faith, all these great heroes. And it starts off by saying, therefore, since we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, and people believe those are all of the saints of old looking down on earth at us. And they're saying, you're surrounded by these witnesses that walked the faith before you. And they're looking and they're hoping that, and they're hoping that we are going to lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. You have a sin, which we all know is bad, and sin will bring death, but then you have a weight. A weight might not be a sin. A weight could be a compromise. A weight could actually be something good, but you're so involved in it, you're missing what's great. Something is taking time away or whatever, or lose whatever. It could be a number of things. But what we are withholding from God, let me ask you this. What are we withholding from God that is causing God to withhold the tremendous blessing he wants to pour out on our life? Let me say that again. What are we withholding from God that is causing God to withhold the tremendous blessing he wants to pour out on our life? That's something I want us to think about as we are transitioning into communion. You know, when we take that cup, the juice that represents the blood that Jesus shed for us, and we take the bread, which represents his broken body for us, is there something that's holding us back from us giving all of ourselves to him? Whatever it is, you got to let it go. You got to let it go. If something is an idol, if something is more important than God, you got to let it go. And that's my prayer, is we're reminiscing on what Christ did on the cross. And if there's something, that you would deal with it and you would ask for God's forgiveness and then move forward on it. But there may be some here that have never given their life to Christ. And this is really a shock. They hear this story about Abraham offering Isaac. That is a picture of what Christ did for you. If you're not saved, that's what God did for you. He sent his son to die that you may live, to forgive you of your sin. The Bible tells us all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And it also tells us it's appointed for men to die once, and after this, judgment. When you die, you're already judged. You can't plead your case in heaven. It's a done deal. You make your decision on earth. Your choice on earth will determine where you go. And you go to one of two places. You go to heaven or you go to hell. And here's the deal. Heaven's not for good people, it's for forgiven people. We all need to come to a place in our life when we realize, I can't do this on my own. I've sinned against you, Lord, and I am sorry, and ask for his forgiveness. And he will forgive, and he will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But you also got to repent from your sins. That means to change direction. Instead of doing what I want, I'm putting God first, and what does he want me to do? So if that's you, just bow your heads. I'm going to say a prayer for you. Lord, I pray for anybody here that doesn't know Christ, that they, if they want to know Christ, that, Lord, they would make that decision to follow you, to repent of their sins, to ask you to be their Lord and Savior. I'm going to say what we call the sinner's prayer. And if that's you, you want to get right with God, you just repeat this prayer after me. This is asking God to forgive you. This is you asking him to be your Lord and Savior. This is you saying that you're willing to repent and put your faith in him and follow him. Just repeat this after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I know you died on the cross for my sins, and I know you rose again from the dead, and I put my faith in you. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I promise to turn from my sins and to follow you all the days of my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. If you said that prayer, fantastic. We have some Bibles back there at the service. Feel free to go there and get one. But right now, we are going to have a communion song, and we're going to invite, and then the song is done. Bart and Melissa are going to come and share some things about communion, and then we're going to have some announcements, and then we're going to have a little prayer time. Amen.
thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Morning, church. I'm going to be reading from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 29 as we prepare for communion. So, for I have received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, for which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever, therefore, eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats or drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." So the notes written out here, sorry. So as we come to the communion table, you know, Paul's given us an outline of the posture of our hearts and minds when approaching communion. When we partake, we're proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. It's an open and public proclamation when we take communion as a body. We're proclaiming this before God himself, each other, the devil and his allies, and the world who watches. Paul goes also on to say, to not eat of the bread and drink of the cup in an unworthy manner. This doesn't mean that we'll ever make ourselves worthy, or we muster ourselves up to be worthy of taking communion, nor can we ever make ourselves worthy of his work on the cross. Instead, it's taking communion in a haphazard or casual manner would be taking it unworthily. So as we take these elements instead, let us remember that we are again reopening our hearts and remembering through his death and resurrection, his presence is now with us and in us. And lastly, Paul tells us to examine ourselves. We are to practice communion in a spirit of self-examination, or like in layman's terms, we're making an appraisal or inventory of where we are in our walk. I love Marty's words earlier. He says, if there's like anything holding on to an idol, you know, or any unconfessed sin, let's lay it out right here before as we take communion. And in reality, until that day when we're with the Lord, we're going to be a work in progress. Amen? So now let us eternally give thanks for that price he paid. His broken body hung and his blood shed on the cross, his death and resurrection to conquer sin and death so we could be with him in eternity. And let's also use this time to let the Holy Spirit recalibrate our hearts so that we can be in alignment with God's will. So would you pray with me, church? Heavenly Father, we just come before you, Lord, just again, coming to you with our hearts open to you and thankful for what you did, that final work on the cross, Lord, you know, paying that ultimate price for our sins and conquering death, Lord. And as we take this bread that represents your body, Lord, just remember that it was broken to beyond recognition, that we couldn't even tell you were a man, Lord. And now as we take this bread, Lord, just help us to examine ourselves, Lord, to take that inventory, Lord. Try us and know our thoughts and our what's deep within our heart, Lord, just any unconfessed sin or any idols or whatever it is, Lord, just show us right now, Lord. Again, Lord, we are eternally thankful, and with this bread we partake.
I'm going to be reading from Isaiah 53, verses 5 through 7. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was a chastisement that was brought us peace. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that before its shears is silent. So he opened not his mouth. Oftentimes when I reflect on communion and what the Lord wants to remind me through the process, I'm brought to Isaiah 53. The whole chapter really is about the picture of our suffering Savior. He was the sinless Lamb of God who came down as a man to take our punishment. We were once the sheep that had gone astray, guilty of sinning before the Lord, and we had no way to redeem ourselves before a holy and just God. But the Father, in love, sent his one and only Son as that ultimate sacrifice. He was crucified as a common criminal. He was struck down, spit upon, and mocked, all for us. He endured physical and spiritual agony for our sakes, and he did this all while we were still sinners. Christ's death paid the price for our past, our present, and our future sins. And reflecting on this humbles me. It reminds me of a time where I had too much pride in my heart to repent. And instead, I passed the elements and I walked away from a service. Every time I take communion, I'm reminded of that young girl. And if I could tell her that whatever she was trying to hold on to was worth it, I'd tell her it wouldn't be, that he was and is the only way, the only truth, and the only life. I love what the Bible tells us in Ephesians 1:4, that even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us to be holy and without fault in his eyes. and that we love him because he first loved us. So as we take communion this morning, church, let's not let it be a religious ritual, but rather a celebration for the true gift that Christ has given us. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, God, we come before you, and God, we truly are humbled at the realization that we were that sheep that were lost. But God, you went after us, and I'm so thankful that you never stopped pursuing us. And even to this day, God, I know that you pursue us with your kindness and your mercy, God. Lord, we remember the blood that was shed on the cross, that we may be healed now, but also for all of eternity. We have the hope of that promise, that we have that day, that one precious day, that we will stand before you or lay flat on our faces, God, because of that gift that you've given us, God. We pray that you would be that reminder to us even now, that we wouldn't drink this cup lightly, but that we truly would just rejoice in that gift. Lord, we love you so much. We thank you again, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us drink.
I believe we're going to have some announcements at this time. Marianne?
Whew. Wow. Thank you, Bart. Thank you, Melissa, for a beautiful time of communion. And thank you, Pastor Marty, for an amazing message. Kind of hard to follow, but I'm here to give the announcements. But I think it's a great message, and looking forward to our Wednesday night Bible study this Wednesday, guys. This Wednesday. What about some excitement for that? It starts on this Wednesday at 7 p.m. We're going to be here at the Woodcrest Library, but it's going to be up campus, upper campus, and the parking will be up there as well. So we're really excited about a Wednesday evening study, and we've been praying for this for a long time, so it's neat to see a praise report. Also, Israel signups. This is a flyer for, we have 7 more openings for those of you that might be interested in Israel. Grab a flyer, we're gonna extend it one more week so it's available, and for those of you that have a heart to go and are able to go, please make sure you grab a flyer and put your deposit. It's not too late. And then women, wow. So many of you have been asking these past months, when are we gonna do a Bible study? What are we gonna do? What's gonna happen? What's going on? We've got a lot planned for you ladies. And we need you guys to mark these dates because we can get a little busy. So March 18th is gonna be our spring event. It's gonna be at Anna's and Andy's house. They're opening up their house once again. We're praying for you ladies. We're excited about the message, the worship, and we would love for you to attend. And this will be open to others. It's just not gonna be for the women of our church. So we will be starting registration next Sunday, and we'll be at the table. So we'll start all of the registration and signups next Sunday. So please plan on attending March 18th. And then also, we're really excited to talk about, I'm really excited to talk about a Bible study that Lori's going to be doing after Easter. I think it's going to be the Thursday after Easter for 3 weeks. It's not going to be too long so that you guys are able to fit it into your much busy calendar. And then not to mention, I have to mention it, is our Women's Summer Series. And so that was a huge blessing last year because we were able to fellowship, get to know each other, and it was really neat to see a lot of the ladies connect. And it was just fun with all the ideas that we did. And I think that's it. Stand up and greet each other.
Hey guys, just church is not over. We're just going to have a little time of greeting, and then we're going to have a few songs and a time of prayer. So it's not over if it's what it looks like. If everybody wants to come back to their seat real quick, we're going to do a worship, comes worship songs. If everybody wants to have a seat real quick. Okay, start playing. I'm gonna dim the lights.
And stand up and worship, please.
Hey guys, what we're going to do is we're going to have a time of prayer while the worship is going on. Jesus said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." And he made church to be a place where we could have prayer. I'm going to have my wife, Pastor Rick, and his wife, we're going to be up here. And if you guys need prayer for an illness, we have an oil will anoint you. God does still heal. If you need prayer for your marriage, anything that's going on in your life, we want to be available to you. But that's what the church is supposed to be. It's supposed to be a house of prayer, is what our Lord told us. So we're going to be available up here. You can stay at your seats and worship. You can sit down, stand up. But if you want to come and pray, we are going to be up here, and we'd love to pray with you guys.
Close by your
are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
It's your breath. up every song we could ever sing. Worthy all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the way we have every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Your heart.
Hey guys, we're going to have one more worship song, but before we worship, I just want to remind you that Wednesday night, we're starting, as we said earlier, we're going to start up the hill here at the library, and we're going to have a Bible study. We're going to go through the book of Ephesians, and then after, we're going to have a prayer time afterwards. And it's going to look a little different every week, but we want to seek the Lord, but we also want to teach His Word. And then after that, we're going through the book of Acts. So I encourage all you guys to come out to that. But right now, let's just finish in a worship song. But let me just say a quick prayer over everybody here. Lord, I pray for this congregation, Lord. I pray that you would bless them, that you would keep them, that you would make your face shine upon them, that you would be gracious unto them, that you would lift up your countenance upon them, that you would give them peace, that, Lord, you would bless their coming in and their going out, Lord, that they would be filled with the fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and self-control, Lord. Answer their prayers. Give them wisdom for any decisions they need to make. Father, help them, guide them in their paths as they go out this week, and just be with them, and may they feel your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Be blessed, church. See you possibly Wednesday midweek Bible study.
Go Chiefs.